prepare a translation wherever this is needed. I am honored today to present this event on behalf of the Institute of World Policy and paper, the Foreign Policy Audit Ukraine-France, which was co-authored by me with together with a group of French experts. And I'd like to say that it was a very uneasy work to do this paper, precisely for because of the nature of the relations between Ukraine and France, which changed so much during the last 2 years. So we've seen various degrees, and I would like to maybe to make some introduction remarks before I give the floor to our distinguished panel guests at this panel. First of all, I'd like to mention that the French relations or Ukraine's relations with France have changed during the last 2 years so much that they didn't in the last 23 years, most probably. Of course, this was partly due to the Russian aggression in Ukraine, but I would say that this was the right thing for the wrong reason, I would say. So we, Ukraine finally managed to get more or less direct track in the relations between Paris and Kyiv. And I think this is a very important element that we can discuss. I think that together with this element, we have one risk. We have a separate chapter in the paper on the risks. And this risk is described is what happens if, let's say, the Minsk agreement is implemented and the conflict in the East is settled. How Kyiv and Paris can keep their relation at the same pace, at the same level as they do now. I think that from the side of Kyiv, as we saw the involvement of Paris in the Normandy format, first of all, has been an enriching experience, has been a very important thing for Ukraine to keep its to keep its, let's say, to enforce the ceasefire in the East, but also to let French public know much more about Ukraine, because this is an important thing. I mean, traditionally, France has been more concerned with the southern dimension than with the eastern dimension. And Normandy format was one of the key, let's say, elements that made French public become much more aware of what happens in Ukraine. And I think that the French public has demonstrated a very high propensity towards and empathy towards what happened in Ukraine. Let me just remember the opinion poll which our institute carried out together with GfK last year, where most of the French public thinks that in Ukraine there is not a civil war taking place, but a Russian aggression towards Ukraine is taking place. And I think this is the narrative which we would like to see in most of the European countries, because this is based on the facts which we see in Eastern Ukraine. Also, I'd like to say that despite the crisis which emerged in a way between EU and, because we cannot speak about Ukraine and France like in a separate world. Of course, it affects the relations with Russia, it affects the relations with the EU. Despite this crisis, I think it became also an opportunity, because a series of French companies became more active, and despite the crisis, no French company left Ukrainian market. I think this is quite important. Also, it is important to note that what we've seen on from the side of Paris towards Ukraine is that we see, and I'm speaking here about the, our perception of the governmental relations with Ukraine, is that we saw a sort of entanglement. On the one side, we see that Ukrainian, that French government and French leadership has been keeping on the track together with Germany on the settlement process and on supporting Ukraine in its endeavors, in the reform process as well. On the other side, we've seen that in France, there is a strong, I would say, I wouldn't be afraid to say, pro-Russian lobby at the political, at the economic level. We've seen certain emanations of this lobby in certain discussions in the French parliament. I've read the entire, how do you call this, transcript of the discussion in the parliament, and I found a lot of interesting facts. Some of them I see that were somehow, we have a different vision, let's say, on this. Let's put it very, very, not very hard. But I think that the key challenge for between Paris and Kyiv for the years to come is how to develop a direct track between Paris and Kyiv, which is not subordinated to the influence of Kremlin, of Moscow. We tried in this paper to avoid bringing Russia into discussion, I mean, and to focus on Ukraine-French relations purely. But this is impossible in the current context. Wherever we can, wherever we want or not, this is impossible. And I think that if Ukraine would, for instance, Ukrainian MPs would take on board the German MPs, for instance, and would talk to their French, to their counterparts in French parliament, I think this would be one of the recommendations that we can take in order to have a smoother dialogue and to have a more convergent visions over how we should further cooperate on this issue. Also, I think that Ukraine could get, for instance, more interest on behalf of France if, for instance, Ukraine, as Georgia does, would participate in more operations, let's say, at the European level, you know, creating trust between partners and so on different theaters, I mean, conflict theaters. I think this is important. And I also think that one element which was until now somehow overlooked is the cooperation at the level of public diplomacy. I mean, the contacts between French and Ukrainians at the different levels are taking place, of course. But these are still limited. I mean, Ukraine has a great culture, has great people. And I think the French public would like to know more about this. And this is one of the tools which, that Ukraine should use in order to make itself more vocal in France. And of course, then it would be also a different, maybe a rising interest of French public towards Ukraine. One last element of my, I would like to keep short because we'd like, we call this a debate. So it's not only a presentation, but it's also a sort of interaction with the public. So one, my last remark I'd like to mention is that I had the impression that on the side of French, both officials, but also experts, one of the key elements to keep the dialogue high on the agenda and to keep Ukraine on the top 10 priorities is to have an efficient process of reforms in Ukraine. So it's not only Minsk, which is very important indeed, but it's also a reform process which we see the support of the French leading the leaders and the French government. And I think this, that this won't change, despite all the calls which sometimes are voiced from various opposition parties, because we think that this is the right thing that France is doing now. Having said this, I think I will stop here. I have a series of recommendations and things to add, but it's difficult to be all embracing in having 7 minutes to talk. So I would like to ask the next speakers also to keep their presentation more or less short, because we'd like to have a debate. So having said this, I would like to pass the floor to Madame Ambassador of France to Ukraine, Isabelle Dumont.
Merci beaucoup. На жаль, я не можу розмовляти українською.
Unfortunately, I cannot speak Ukrainian yet, but I hope that the next year I will be able to speak Ukrainian during all my presentation. Thank you very much.
A few quick words, because I think, as you said, it's more interesting and important to exchange and answer to questions if there are. I agree with most, not all, because otherwise it wouldn't be fun, but with most of the things that you said. I would add to that. And I will come back then on what you said on how Ukraine can make herself know better. But I think concerning the Franco-Ukrainian relationship, there is something that is also lacking, maybe from our side, but also maybe from Ukrainian side, is to show more how France is present. And part of your report, I think, is a bit sort of, you know, negative in terms of French presence and French ties with Ukraine, but some things needs to be recalled. I'm not going to tell again about Ando Kiev, because this is important, but this is very traditional. But if we speak about today's history, the role of France tends to be a bit forgotten here, not only since the conflict, but with the association agreement, all the efforts that, well before, I mean years ago, all the French efforts to support Ukraine's work towards the association agreement. It's not so much in the report, I'm not criticizing, but I mean this is overall, in general, something that might be recalled more, I think, if we need to talk about the role that France is playing. It's not only in the past 2 years, it's well before that. Another point is Chernobyl. People tend to forget the role of France in Chernobyl. We are the second country in terms of funds given in Chernobyl, and people, you know, I'm not sure that the Ukrainian public knows about that. The arch that is going to be pushed on the reactor at the end of the year, of this year, is built by French companies with a huge human and financial investment from France. So those are, for those who want to push forward the Franco-Ukrainian relationship, I think those are things to just recall, otherwise the public doesn't have this in mind. And for us, Chernobyl is extremely important, because it's a human project. I mean, this is about saving lives and saving the nature in this area, and not only for Ukraine. This is about engineering, a huge project in Ukraine. This is about building bilateral relations also, because there are a lot of cooperations with Ukraine, between French and Ukrainian specialists. Another point that is not, I think, very well known is the business. We have in Ukraine more than 160 French companies, which is actually quite a lot. They play an important role. We have banks, like big banks, and you know, big shops that I'm not going to name, but I'm sure you have them in mind. Those are also real French presence in Ukraine. You mentioned very much the role of France in the conflict. I'm not going to go back to it now, but happy to answer to questions. Now, and we have, we really want, and you told about that, and you're totally right, to give a new impetus to the Franco-Ukrainian relation, not only because of our involvement on the Minsk process, but really our aim is building up on the Minsk process to develop the Franco-Ukrainian bilateral relationship. and we have diverse spheres of interests, and this is our role here, my role as an ambassador, the role of the embassy, to work on that. There are main areas, I would say, agriculture, transport, energy efficiency, obviously after the COP21, this is a very important area, and environment in general. Decentralization, where I think, and this is also, I think, maybe is not understood as well as it could here, to what extent the French example can be used here, because we are so closed in terms of centralization, decentralization, and what we call deconcentration. Another area that is extremely important for developing the future relation is university cooperation and research. So those are our main focus. Coming back very shortly on what you said that we should let the French public know more about Ukraine. You're totally right. Obviously, this is also our aim. Public diplomacy, yes, there needs certainly more public diplomacy from Ukraine, and believe me, we are ready to help whenever needed. This is part of also of our job. You know, there was this Jamala competition, I mean, not the Jamala competition, but the Eurovision some weeks ago. I think it's tremendous for Ukraine. I mean, this is typically, sure, I mean, you know, if she won, that's very good. You cannot just have it by, but this is typically the sort of thing that is, I think, helping Ukraine to show something positive about Ukraine. As you mentioned that also. So I think we should find other sorts of examples like that to show a positive face of Ukraine. Another example that I think is understated is the excellency of Ukraine, for example, in the area of IT. We know that, you know that, specialists know that, and including French specialists, they know to what extent Ukraine is really excellent in IT. But maybe this could be shown even more. And last but not least, obviously, I would say that the best ambassadors for any country are the investment people, the companies, French we are talking about France, so that would be the French companies. And you mentioned it, I think, fostering the business climate would really help. This is something that is being done, but more that can be done, and really having a better business climate will bring new French companies that will talk to others, say to what extent it's now getting better to invest in Ukraine, and those are really your best ambassadors to develop the bilateral relation. And just to, as you stopped on that, I will stop on the, you said that Ukraine is one of the top 10 priorities of France. I would disagree with you on that and say that Ukraine is one of the top 5 priorities of France, and this is really the case. And as a teaser to stop on that, I will tell you that in some days probably we will publish on the internet a reportage, but like a video, you know, a documentary on how to become an ambassador. This is a 20-minute movie, you know, on what training you get, etc. And there you see the diplomatic, in this movie, you see the diplomatic advisor of the French president telling the future ambassador of France to Ukraine to what extent Ukraine is really one of the very few top priorities. So this is my very, very small disagreement with you, if I may.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador. We can certainly discuss this during the part of the presentation. Now I will give the floor to Mr. Vasyl Khymynets, who who is the Director General of the First European Department at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Ukraine.
Thank you, good afternoon. Let me first thank for this invitation for to take part in this press conference, this discussion. Here, I am the only Ukrainian among my French colleagues, and I support the idea of Ms. Ambassador that the next time she is going to speak with us in Ukrainian, and I'm going to speak Ukrainian now, and also I support the opinion of Ms. Ambassador, and I will tell about some things about bilateral agreements. Firstly, I would like to tell several words about the research. I read this report with great interest, and I would like to say that the authors carried out huge quality work, and a lot of materials, information was analyzed. They made interesting conclusions that draw our attention. And for us, this is interesting material in order to improve our work. And I agree with the previous speakers, and I want to say that there are some additions to the proposals, to conclusions, and to work on the whole. Dear ladies and gentlemen, I think that I won't deliberate much in this matters because we know that for us, cooperation is really important. Fruitful cooperation with France is important for us. This is wonderful, powerful country, one of the most influential countries in the European Union. And I know that in countries of Europe, people believe that Germany and France are the drivers of European idea. And in this context, all we clearly understand that for us, it is very important to have these fruitful relationship and contacts at all levels with France. At the same time, we understand that France is an economic power, and of course, the deepening of cooperation in the sphere of trade and economic relationship is very important for us. This is a very important case for us. So, as a country, as society, that aspires reforms and change. This is an invaluable help from our French counterparts because we want to carry out reforms. And this ambassador told us about the issues of decentralization. Now we have support in this sphere, but also there are many other spheres where we need and welcome support and advice from our French friends and partners. We can analyze our relationship. I would like to say that we should not only consider it as bilateral relationship, but we can speak about broader context, European context. We may analyze the situation on the whole. So France, Germany, and other partners, they are ready for cooperation in the European context. And also, we should take into account the internal situation in our state and also the internal situation, domestic affairs in France. We understand that during the last months, some developments are on the way, and we should analyze the situation.
But I support the opinion that was voiced here that in order to create dialogue and not to depend on the third parties, we should build our bilateral cooperation and we should strengthen mutual trust. I believe that as of today, during the past year at least, bilateral agreements with France, they are of quality now at the new stage of its development, and I believe that we didn't have it previously. Maybe someone has a different opinion. And of course, we are ready for discussion and we are ready to analyze the situation. We established good cooperation at the level of top officials of the state. There is political dialogue, and this political dialogue creates and broadens possibilities for bilateral cooperation. I would like to say that we are in close contact and dialogue at the level of the Ministries of Foreign Affairs, Minister Klimkin, with his French counterpart, Monsieur Hervé. So this is important because these contacts, this dialogue is important in order to exchange ideas. And there should be mutual trust that is lacking sometimes while taking some decisions. Also, I would like to say that France is very important for us in the process, the Norman process. And I believe that this process it's not the topic of our discussion today, but I would like to thank France for the attention from the side of French top officials and diplomats to the issues of Russian aggression, because this is an acute question for us. And French colleagues, together with their German counterparts, and here among us, we have good contact that helps us to defend our interests in this format. But going back to bilateral bilateral relationship, we also considered and we see that there is inter-parliamentary dialogue and resolutions adopted during the last months. They are of concern to us, and it shows that for us it is important to also cooperate between our parliaments. And also, I was on a visit to Paris with our Minister of Foreign Affairs, and I attended the meeting at the National Assembly. And also, we were participating on the committee. And it is evident that we should establish dialogue with French parliamentarians, and we should explain to them our position and to show examples what is going on in our country. Also, I would like to say that in our Supreme Council there is an there is a parliamentarian group that is headed by young active deputies that often visit Paris or invite their French counterparts, and this is an important cooperation for us. And also, we should, in the context of this discussion, we should focus on the fact that international law is of special value. This is a fundamental value in international cooperation. And some people in the assembly, in the Senate, they do not clearly understand the depth of violations of Russia in the context of Russian aggression. One more proposal from me. We should strengthen our cooperation by developing inter-regional cooperation. So there is a clear field for cooperation. And as of today, we have cooperation between Lille and Kharkiv, Marseille, and Odessa. And I know that our ambassador attended both cities, and there is an interest in cooperation, and we presented all our proposals to Ukrainian partners in Kharkiv, Odessa, and we believe that we will pay more attention to this factor. And now cooperation between Kyiv and Paris is on the agenda, and the mayor of Kyiv is popular in Paris, and we hope that this factor will be favorable. And in summer, in August, there will be a festival in the Bretagne region. This is a festival of culture. This is one more chance in order to present Ukrainian culture to French public, and we pay a lot of attention to this, and we expect for support from the public, from the expert communities, and public diplomacy is very important, and its contribution is truly valuable. So I will stop here. Thank you very much, and I'm glad to take part in this discussion. I would like to thank you, and I would like to say that we invited Mr. Gonchirenko to this discussion, but unfortunately there is a plenary session.
Offer the floor to Mr. Jean-Jacques Hervé, who is the board member for agriculture issues at Crédit Agricole Bank in Ukraine. Mr. Hervé, you can
go. Thank you, Leonid. I'm also the vice president of the Chamber of Commerce between France and Ukraine, and a member of the Union of Radnik po ekonomicheskim voprosom, pitaniam. And so I would like first to say that indeed the climate has changed during the last 2 years. But in spite of that, and in spite of the losses for some of our French enterprises, no one has left Ukraine. I want to underline that, because this should be put forward as a proof that the French enterprises not only have the obligation to remain where they are, but have also finally a trust in the future of Ukraine. Probably Isabelle mentioned the large retail companies. We won't name it, but it's well known. Indeed, that company has lost one of its supermarkets in the Donetsk region. This is a big loss. Has lost a perspective of growth in Crimea. This is also a big loss. The company lose also 25% probably of sales because of the impact of the crisis on the power of the consumers of Ukraine. But in spite of that, the company remains. And the Ukrainians are confident with the philosophy of that company, which tries to reduce the cost and to bring products with the European standards for quality and security. And this is very important, in my view, to underline this. Indeed, if we look at the French enterprise, I would not like you to correct your report, Leonid, but I was a bit surprised by some wordings on the French enterprise that said show that probably we have to increase our common knowledge of what they are doing, and probably to show where they have invested. probably the East Tray of these is enterprises would be more interested to show to the Ukrainians, because that would show that the roots of the development of French enterprises in Ukraine are not yesterday. They begin largely before, and before revolutions. And probably this is important. Indeed, agri-sector is a fuel at the moment of Ukrainian economy. And we are very happy to be there in Ukraine. We have farmers who have settled down. Large ones in a holding, at least one large holding. But we also have farmers who are running some 10,000 hectares of land in several places. They are working properly. Sometimes they are under the pressure of unfair guys in Ukraine. And indeed, they would like to be, and this is something that applies probably to all the aspects of cooperation, more stability, larger stability. Stability, for instance, for using the land. Stability for using water resources to have irrigation, to develop a tool that will provide Ukraine with real possibility to develop its growth potential of food production. And probably that we should be aware of the fact that the free trade agreement between European countries and Ukraine is a great thing, but that should be really reviewed. Because in my view, as a specialist of agribusiness, I do not see what it will bring to both Ukraine and France, or both Ukraine and Europe. For a very simple reason, that Ukraine is already, before the free trade agreement, a large exporter of grain and oil to European countries. Only last year, 10 million tons of grains. What a quota will bring more than what already exists? Nothing. So probably we have to put on the table how we, and after I would like also to underline the quotation by Isabelle Dumont of the fact that in France we had the COP21. What we will put on the table to get free from gas energy? What can we do together? The production of straw in Ukraine for energy is bigger than the production of grain. So there is a huge potential to develop the use of biomass together. European countries are net importers of proteins from crops. 66% at least from South America, Central America, and other countries. Most of them GMOs. Don't you think that we should put on the table how to get rid of that dependence and to have with the Ukraine, who has 42 million hectares of land, good land, that is as much as France and Germany together, as mentioned the head of the European Department, they are working together. We could do something in that field. We could really do something. Foreseeing for next 10, 20 years, because it will not be tomorrow. So I would myself, just to remain in time, I would say three words probably. One that you mentioned, Leonid, which is very important, people. People, and especially youth. Yesterday, our ambassador was opening a new field for competence and for brought up people with French language and French education. I do believe that we have to develop these relations. We have to support the appetite of probably not only learning in France, but also to bring there some of our good guys to learn in Ukraine, to have a better understanding, to prepare the future. Because people is key factor. People in the regions, people in the agricultural regions that would discover Ukraine, that would see that they could do something there, that they may propose to their sons to have their enterprise in Ukraine, and to bring people also to European countries to work as well. Indeed, there are things that we could not probably afford, but that would be important. And the two other words is stability, indeed, confidence. Confidence is essential for an enterprise to develop. And what is the confidence made of? Confidence is made on the fact of the rule of the law, is the real law of the country. this has still to be improved, and that justice is working, really, so that the companies may be enough sure when they invest the money that they will be enable to use the money to develop added value, to create employment, and to develop. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hervé, for your presentation, for very interesting highlights.
Дякую, пане Ерве, за вашу презентацію, за такий огляд практичної економічної сторони стосунки. Я хочу представити пана Олів'є Ведріна, який є професором, французьким експертом, президентом континентального європейського
TV program on UA Perche, UAT time. We have more than 100 recordings. And we started in the 7th of July 2015. And we are doing influence, pro-Ukrainian and pro-European influence. I read your report. And as a professor, you know, automatically I have some key points and some corrections. I share a large part of views of your report. But I want to add some analysis. And in 3 points, and after that I will do some recommendations. 3 points. First of all, you wrote something about the election, no, the election, the vote in the French Assembly and in the Senate. First of all, I want to underline that in the French Assembly, only almost 50 votes to stop the sanction. Okay? In the Senate, the vote has no power. This is only a symbolic one. Okay? Then, in this point, you have to do, I think, a new strategy of communication if you want to talk about the Russian lobbying in France. You give, and you are giving a lot of power to the Russian lobbying in France. You always put in front line of your communication, the result of this Russian lobbying. Then you participate to give to them the power. And I think this is a big mistake and strategic mistake of communication. Instead of that, instead of showing that the Russian lobbying is powerful, please show that the Ukrainian lobbying is doing something. Show that the Ukrainian lobbying is doing something. Show that our company still stay in Ukraine. Show that some deputy in our assembly are pro-Ukrainian. Say that some NGO are working for Ukraine. And that's, I think, a strategic mistake to put a lot of power with your media on the result of the vote of the lobbying in Russia. I want to underline a second point about that. If we do an analysis of the Russian lobbying, they represent very few deputies and politicians. Extreme right party, extreme left party, some in right party, some in left party, but not a lot. There are some marginal. But they know how to use the communication and how to influence. Then if I have to do a recommendation about your report and about the strategy of Ukraine, stop to be defensive and be offensive. Attack. Attack. Go. Show. Win. Stop and fight. Then underline the work of the pro-Ukrainian in France and in Europe. That's some key points. Other key points. I am agree with you when you talk about Russian lobbying. But if I come back to this Russian lobbying and the person who are involved in that, a large part of them don't know Russia, never went in Russia. They dream about Russia. They don't know. That's why Sputnik, other media element of the Russian wing, are very powerful, because they talk to a population pro-Putin who don't understand really Russia. And that's why you have to be more active and more offensive and help the pro-Ukrainian in France and in Europe. Because really, the knowledge of the pro-Putin are very weak about Russia. That's the three key points. My recommendations will be, in Ukraine, for me, we have two big elements, two wars. The war in the East. And really, I am agree with you, this is the war, the occupation of Crimea, the occupation of Donbass, is a problem of international law. And we have to underline that every time. This is a violation of international law, and we cannot change the borders in Europe, in the open continent like that, because we can go to a new war, continental war. Then you have this problem of international law, and you have this problem of war in the Donbass and the occupation of Crimea. Occupation is very important. Occupation of Crimea. And the second war. If you want to win definitely in the mind of the European citizen and French citizen, you have to do the reforms. And the first reforms is against corruption. We are waiting for that. The company, French company, are waiting for that. What about corruption? Corruption is still there. Decrease, yes, slowly. You know, when I do conference in some university, I say, I am waiting for one law in Ukraine, only one law. In France, in Germany, in Europe, when you pay tax, you have to prove from where come your income, how you earn your money and from where. If you cannot prove, you are guilty. Then I am waiting for this law in Ukraine. Because in Ukraine, you don't have to prove from where your income comes from. Only this law. And you know that a lot of experts are waiting for this. That's my conclusion. War against corruption, for me, is a key issue. And this international violation, violation of the international law. Thank you.
Thank you for your interesting points. I think we can discuss all of these points. Indeed, there were a lot of ideas. Some of them are written in the report, like Chernobyl, for instance, and also what you mentioned about the business. We indeed make the case for the French business in Ukraine in the report. If you look at, we collected the complaints from French business. For instance, they are not, sometimes they don't get the VAT. Sometimes they are not able to take off the dividends. Sometimes it's a problem for prolongation of visa for their families. So we collected all this and we put all this so we make sure that decision makers in Ukraine read this. But at the same time, the audit is an instrument, our report is an instrument to make Ukrainian decision makers and interested stakeholders to be more visible in France and to act proactively, as you mentioned. Well, we don't say we attack, we act proactively in terms of that we try to build a narrative which we see as being proper for the relations between France and Ukraine. And yeah, it's a pity that maybe I didn't mention the association agreement to the extent which it was supposed to mention. But unfortunately, we were not able to get the comments from and interviews with all the interested partners for this report. Having said this, I think I will open the floor for discussions with your permission, and I would like to first give the floor to people who already registered for comments. So Mr. Gennady Dmitrievich, Mr. Chizhikov Gennady Dmitrievich, please. I think as you wish. I mean, we don't have a standard procedure.
Thank you very much for this possibility to say a couple of words about the French-Ukrainian relations. I'm of course not a big specialist in the policy, but I think I can say more about the economical relation and some my personal point of view. First of all, we needed to understand what France and Ukraine is the biggest country in Europe. And we needed to understand, but we are not neighbor. That's why we needed to create our relations. It's not just because historically we have some relation. Second point, we've got our relation through the focus of the post-Soviet stereotypes, etc. We needed to create some new history of Ukraine and France relations. This is very important. And I still remember 22 years ago, I studied in France at Rennes University. And my colleagues from university, professor asked, where are you from? I say, I'm from Ukraine. Where is? It was a big question for France, where is Ukraine? Because for honestly speaking, for France, it was Poland, the Romania, and Russia. This is a historical question. It's not the problem of the French. And now we, after 22 years, we made his dramatical jump in forward. Everybody in France know what's Ukrainian. What's Ukraine associated with the democracy, with the people who would like to make new country. This is very important. And as I agreed with the Madam Ambassador, what now we, after we just Ukraine, where are you? And now we, and the five priorities. This is a historical moment for Ukraine. We are became the subject of Ukraine, European policy. This is very important for us, for Ukraine, first of all. Second, I would like to concentrate it a little bit about the economical relations. I agree with Mr. Hervé. First of all, for Ukrainian, for Ukrainian business, we need to understand. No one French investment, not lose our country. This is very important. French and French business understands the huge potential of Ukraine. And it's pity what our economical relations not so big like our country, like our potential. But at the same time, we need to understand the role of the French business in some very key economical spheres is quite important. Banking system. We need to understand, of course, not official, but our national bank do a lot, but without French banks in Ukraine, it will be more difficult to stabilize our economical situation. I can say about this. Also, we needed to say about the huge role of the French businesses, agriculture business, and modernization of agriculture sector of Ukraine. Next one, it's energy safety. This is French joke, what we don't have in France nothing to save because everything was saving before in 20 years. And they share their knowledge with Ukraine, with us. And also, new culture of retailing, it's also connected with the huge French companies. I would like to say, from one side, we have not very big figures in our relations, but from other side, the French business played very important role in some points, stabilized role in our economy. And finishing, I would like to say what, Leonid, I read your discussion paper. It's, I like what you named discussion paper. It's not final decision. It's final, it's imminent. And I am not agreeing only in one point with you. What you a little bit pessimistic. And when you're saying what France is losing interest to Ukraine. From my point of view, it's like image, if you would like. When they pair wedding, it's one relations. After two years, in the family, it's absolutely different. And we are on the way right relations, bear the tribes, and we believe one to another. Thank you very much.
I assume this was a comment, the last one, but also a question for me. I take it as such, but I'd like maybe we can collect some more comments, questions, and then we can turn to the to our speakers. Please introduce yourself and ask your question.
Thank you very much. My name is Vitaly Martinyuk. I am from the Ukrainian Center for Independent Political Research. And I would address my question to Her Excellency Ambassador of France in Ukraine. And the question is, what is the position, what are views of France on deployment of the OSCE police mission in eastern Ukraine? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Are there any other questions at this point or comments? If not, then we proceed with the answers right now. Please, Madam Ambassador, you have the floor.
I will be very, very quick because on the substance, I would say that that this is under discussion in Vienna. So our colleagues in Vienna are now discussing, and this is a fine-tuning to be made on this issue. And the second thing is that I think the issue discussed today is bilateral relations between France and Ukraine. So I would stick to that.
Thank you, Mr. Hervé.
The Honorable Counsel Gennady, I would take two examples. Banking in Ukraine. A French bank is among the three best banks in Ukraine. You know that. That bank, as you know very well, as you know, could probably work more in Ukraine. Why don't we work more? Because we have a bank who have shareholders, and the shareholders are somehow afraid of Ukraine. They are not ready to allow us to put more money, even if we have a lot of arguments, you may believe me, that we present to be more active. And especially in the sectors where we are not losing money and sometimes even winning something. That helps developing some bilateral cooperations in the culture, in the exchange of students and so on. Why? Because our shareholders, the French peasants, are not ready to bet more on Ukraine. And why aren't they ready? But because, for instance, they've taken a very simple example, the VAT return. On one side, a big progress. There are two registers where it's possible now to know publicly the amount of money to be returned to the exporters. Why two? We don't know. Probably good reasons somewhere. But the register to know who has been repaid is different, so that you cannot put together those who had a right to receive the money and those who received the money. We know why. You know why. We have an idea of the word that we should pronounce to explain why. So please, support quickly a change in the law so that the register is one. Second example, you ask for investments for modernization of the business in Ukraine. I will not speak of IT, where you are probably the best in the world. I will speak of agri-system and agriculture, and on a very important aspect of inputs that are really key for modernization, seeds, seed industry. We have at least two large plants for seed production in Ukraine, two French companies, the largest in Ukraine, the largest in Europe. They plan to have a very large plant, both companies, in order to feed the Ukrainian market, the Russian market, and other markets. but the Russian market is closed. So it's closed also the Kazakh market and the other markets in the ICS countries. So they need to export to European countries. But after 2-3 years asking to have the European equivalence, which is the basic thing to have the authorization to export, we still have not received these documents. Why? Because there are battles inside the academy, inside the services, inside the radar, which are absolutely ununderstandable for us, but they are blocking the development of everyone. So do you think that once again, the shareholders, these two companies are cooperatives in France? Do you think that the good peasants will say, yes, we will put more money? Please do the real thing to be done now, excuse me, to be directive, so that some more investments are coming to your country.
Please, Mr. Olivier Védrine.
Yes, I want to add a comment to do like a small conclusion of your comment, Jean-Jacques. You know, for me, we are now in a crossroad. You, in your report, you talk about Ukraine fatigue, yes? Something like that.
Mm-hmm. An emerging Ukraine fatigue, I would say.
You know, I believe in the Ukraine people, at first. And the future of Ukraine is the Ukrainians. This is obvious, but we have to underline that. That's mean why? Why we have to underline that? My friend and colleague Jean-Jacques say, you have to do that, you have to do that. You have to. Don't wait everything from abroad. And that's a key point. You know, the Ukrainian want to know, yes, US supporters, IMF supporters, EU supporters, does France support us? We are ready to support you. You know, we are ready. And you have a big historical chance now to have the support of all the free world. Don't lose this chance. That means do your own work. Your people is waiting for that. The civil society is pushing for the reform. The future of Ukraine is in the hands of the Ukrainians.
I think, if I may just add a few issues, I think that this report precisely look at this. If you observe, you look at the third chapter is drawing the risks that could be in the relation between France and Ukraine, and how this relation could be maintained and maybe expanded. Why not? I mean, I don't think the relations reached the highest, let's say, potential. And also, we try to help the Ukrainian, all the Ukrainian stakeholders involved or interested in getting France closer to Ukraine, let's say. We have the fourth chapter, which is drawing on who is who, both in all the French institutions. So people here know whom they should talk in France in order to get way on board, because I admit that France, for instance, knows little about Ukraine, but a lot of things happened in Ukraine as well. I mean, during last 2 years, compared 2013 with current days, it's not worth comparing, I think. And there were certain beginnings, and probably I'm the first time the advocate of the current government, but in the context of our discussion, I would like to mention that key anti-corruption institutions were created in Ukraine. Now we need to demonstrate how whether this is a sustainable work, because if this was created only on paper, it's one thing, but I think that their start is quite encouraging. So therefore, I think that we, on the contrary, we need to encourage and draw on this experience. Also, I mean, France experience on these issues, and in developing business as well, and in implementing the association agreement. I think this is a big change for Ukraine. which will bring new I'm not speaking only about the geopolitical context, if I may, because there were companies which came after the crisis, like Angie, for instance, yeah, like other companies. We have a big chapter on this, but or for instance, Areva in 2015 signed a contract, or many companies, French companies, which were weighted. Thales in radar equipment, a lot of French companies which were weighted on the Ukrainian market, and precisely this type of contacts are the contacts which develop the relations between the two. Now I don't know whether this would be enough for Ukraine to remain on top five. As Ambassador mentioned, priorities. I know that in Germany, Ukraine is top three. I would like to see at some point Ukraine being in France top three. And not only because of political reasons, certainly, but also because of public diplomacy, because of intense economic relations. Because these days, Russia goes down because of its problems with the economy. And it's not necessarily caused by sanctions. And Ukraine is a country which is getting out of the crisis, if I may say so. So here is the potential. So I will portray just the debate in a little bit more positive narrative, if I may. Mr. Khymynets, would you like to react on any of the comments until now, questions?
Yes.
Yes, please.
In my speech, I avoided consciously the factor of trade cooperation or business relationship, because I understand that this is a separate topic for discussion, and there will be interesting discussions on this. I fully agree with what was said. Economic factor is the factor where we can reach a lot, not only in the economic success that is important in itself, but to highlight the interest to Ukraine in France to provide more information. I fully agree. We reached a lot in the past 2 years, and of course, not many people know about the success. And this is our task, the task of our diplomacy, and also this is a task of civil society, expert community, and business people to get involved in this work. This is not only a task of ours, but also the task for our French counterparts. We should reach synergy. We should see that a lot has been achieved. We will have problems, and we are realists, and we see that it is rather difficult to achieve our goals. Of course, this will be done, but we should get support. And for this, we have association agreement that is the instrument for our reforms. And I agree that this is our task, our Ukrainian task. But let's search for the possibilities to deepen our cooperation and to carry out these discussions in Kyiv and in other cities of Ukraine. And we should have a lot of discussions like this in France, in Paris, in Lille, in Marseille, in other cities, in different regions. And I believe that if we cooperate from both sides, and they will get these signals, and this should be done by business people and also by experts and those who study politics. And I see my task and the task of our service, we should create platforms, opportunities for these discussions, And in the nearest future, in autumn, there will be a business forum investment conference that should have been held in November, but there were objective reasons. It was postponed. But this forum is really important. So we see our task, our goal, to join efforts. And one of the instruments is to organize discussions like this in France and to show prospects here in Ukraine and to involve French partners in cooperation with our country.
By the way, Mr. Gennady mentioned about the fact that I'm a little bit pessimist. Well, I got some impression, some notes, some flavor of pessimist sometimes when I was in Paris for preparing the interviews for this report. So this is does not come from somewhere. And we had a very nice public debate also, aside from interviews in Paris, which actually showed a great interest from the side of French public. We got, I think, almost 200 participants at this debate. This is an interesting format which has to be replicated, maybe in, as you said, in Lille, in Marseille. Well, Marseille is a little bit dangerous lately after the match, but still.
But on the example of Marseille, French people understood who is who, are those fans, and how they really act, their behavior. There were negative examples, but I believe that in Lille, there was a match on Sunday. There were some Ukrainian fans, and they demonstrated their culture. And in other cities, and the championship also was carried out, and our embassy also cooperate with the FIFA. So there is a chance to represent our state through the behavior, ethics of our fans.
We mentioned earlier, so what our people, I mean, Ukrainians can go to France and show their knowledge. It's important that they all get visas, of course, to get there, because the visa issues from the both sides is existent, I think. So if there are any other questions and comments, please do address them. I see one hand there and one hand there. And
two questions for Her Excellency. Je m'appelle Georges Sherman, journaliste Ligonet. Votre Excellence, 20 mai, le ministre.
Excuse me, everyone understands French.
I will translate later.
Oh, okay.
Votre Excellence, ministre de l'Intérieur français, Bernard Cazeneuve, a déclaré que la France n'est pas prête à donner le régime sans visa pour l'Ukraine. Est-ce que c'est là la position officielle de la France? Est-ce que la France pourrait donner le régime sans visa pour l'Ukraine cette année? Мой вопрос относительно режима.
My question about visa-free regime. Is it possible to obtain this regime from the side of France to Ukraine? Because this year the minister said that France isn't ready. And second question.
Du Sénat français, est-ce que cette résolution aura-t-elle les conséquences pratiques pour la décision du monsieur président François Hollande au sujet des sanctions contre la Russie, et pourquoi le Parti socialiste, le parti du président français, a voté pour cette résolution. И второй вопрос относительно санкций.
And second question about sanctions. About resolution of French Senate, will it have practical impact, and why the Socialist Party voted for this? Alexandre.
Thank Maidan for Foreign Affairs, and I've got two questions to the most popular, it seems to me, a figure on this stage, Her Excellency. It's a rather philosophical question. First, do you and people, and especially political elite in France, realize that without accommodation of Ukraine's nation interest to live in a sovereign, independent from Russia, certainly, state, it's impossible to have peace, security, and stability in Ukraine and in Europe as a whole. And the process as it goes does not serve to this cause. And the position of France is worrisome. And second question, if we have a look at the Ukrainian relations with any country, in particular with France, we need to proceed from and to see it from three dimensions. First, values. And certainly there is no contradiction between what stated in France and Ukraine and what the Ukrainian nation is wants to leave. Secondly, it's how other countries help us to withstand the Russian aggression. And we've got a mixed feeling about France. Certainly you did not recognize the occupation of Crimea, as you call it, it's illegal annexation. Secondly, you didn't sell a Mistral to Russians. From the other hand, the participation in the Minsk process that I consider as a dead end with no prospects at all and with huge damage to Ukrainian statehood. And third dimension is the future, future interests, and how France can accommodate our interest to live in Europe and live in peace and security. I mean, European integration, joining EU and NATO. And here we see that the French position rather skeptical to Ukraine. How can you and France in general make out of this mess something doable, something accommodative for both nations? Thank you.
Excuse me, could you please repeat the first question?
Okay, so the first question is there is understanding in among the French elite that without accommodation of Ukrainians' aspiration to live in sovereign state, it's impossible to have peace, security, stability in Europe. I mean that some actions of the French political elite and officials it's sort of appeasement of Russia, recognition of their sphere of influence over Ukraine, the concept of limited sovereignty over Ukraine, and so on and so on. So it doesn't lead to the peace and security in Ukraine, neither in Europe as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. There are four questions, so I will try to be short on each of them. Sir, on your two questions, I will start with the second one on the Senate vote. Just very quickly to remind you what is the official position of the French government. It has been stated several times, officially in the media, publicly, that France will keep the sanctions. First, it's, as you know, it's not a decision of the French government, it's an EU decision, so it's not only about France, but for the French position, the French position is very clear, which is that sanctions have to stay until the Minsk agreements will not be implemented by Russia. On the text of the Senate, I think the reason why it was so overwhelmingly voted by more than 300 senators is that you indeed have at the end of the text, if you read it or you can read it, at the end of the text you have the wish expressed to lift sanctions for well-known reasons, because the French economy is suffering quite a lot because of sanctions. So there is the expression of a wish, but if you read the text, you will see very important things on the fact that Russia is the aggressor, that the annexation of Crimea is illegal, that France doesn't recognize, that sanctions are linked with Minsk implementation, and so on and so forth. So, as it was discussed by and also others said before me, that there is this idea of how Ukraine can present itself and and you know, if I may say, sell itself. I think this is one of the typical examples where there are two ways to read this text. One way would be for Ukraine to see the first paragraphs and to value the first paragraphs of this text. But again, to answer directly your question, the position of the French government is very clear: keep sanctions until the implementation of Minsk agreements is not done. On your first question of on the visas, on this again, it's not a secret. The French position is also very clear. France is in favor of liberalization of visas for Ukraine. There are, as you know, discussions going on in Brussels now, negotiations going on to enable visa liberalization while preserving interests. Again, on this issue also, it's not only about France, it's also, it's a European policy, so it's, you know, 28 member states, each of them having its own difficulties and concerns in a difficult environment now, as you know, so this is underway and there is a work being done. But again, on this, the French position is clear: France is in favor of visa liberalization. I would just add, if you allow me a point on that, you've all seen that there was a huge issue. I mean, huge. Actually, I think just some journalists have been, I don't know by whom they were supported. You might want to think about it. I will not go further, but there were journalists who made a big case of a story last week with a family that who wanted to go to France for the Euro. As you know, thousands of people got visas. They all gave, you know, their files, dossier, without problem, and got their visa within some days, and it's continuing. Every day we issue hundreds of visas. So one might want to, I'm just raising this issue because it has been so high in the agenda, and I have a chance to talk about it today. I think, I mean, people who are friends of Ukraine and Ukrainians who are friends of Ukraine might want to think what happened last week and what pushed people to make this big case about a dossier that, as you know, was extremely poor, extremely problematic, that made the French people look into it, see to what extent it was problematic, and how the Ukrainian public tended to say that it was not a problem. I don't want to go much farther publicly here, but this is a real issue. As a result of it, and this really is not helping. I mean, this is typically a sort of case that is not helping, because as a result, the idea that is, you know, given is that some people, but pushed in the media by whomever. Again, you judge yourself, but I don't. I think not necessarily friends of Ukraine. That and the idea is that Ukrainians basically don't care about rules. You know. So at the end, the family, as you know, they finally wrote the necessary documents, and finally we were able to issue the visa, because at the end, after some days, we got everything that was needed. But again, the way that it was presented in the media is I think worrisome, and I'm a bit surprised that it went so high, and that no one tried to explain. I tried, but it was cut every time. But I'm a bit surprised that no one tried to explain to the people, instead of letting it go, explain to the people what was happening and why this family didn't have their visa while thousands got their visa. On the two other questions that are a bit similar.
Your Excellency, dear guest, I'm very sorry to interrupt. We have 1 minute left.
Okay, very good. Excellent. Mixed feelings about France on its supporting of Ukraine. Well, I would say that I understand that in Ukraine there might be mixed feelings about France, and this is totally understandable. As an ambassador of France, I would like, obviously, all the 45 million Ukrainians to like France and want to and understand the huge support of France given to Ukraine. What I can tell you is that there are no mixed feelings in the French government. And when you have the French president spending tens and tens of hours to support Ukrainian sovereignty, I wouldn't call it mixed feelings.
We have, we have to close, although we have some comments still and some questions, but I would like to just to do this after we close, we can discuss, continue discussion on this. And thank you for this. That's why it's good that we have such events, because you have the opportunity to explain directly the misunderstandings or something which was badly taken. On this note, I'd like to thank Pact Ukraine USA for their generous support. I'd like to thank Ukraine Crisis Media Center, of course, for hosting us. And I'd like to remind you that Foreign Policy Audit is a big, big project with evaluating many, many countries' bilateral relations. Next week, on 23 June, we have the presentation on Ukraine-Romania relations. So please feel invited, and we'll be very glad to have you. Please join me in thanking our panel for this very nice discussion.